Thank you, Pastor Ken, and thank you, orchestra, thank you, choir, and thank you, saints. If you would please turn with me in your Bibles to Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1, as we look this morning at some characteristics of powerful and transforming prayer. And as we get started this morning, I'd like to thank Dr. and Mrs. Connor and the staff of First Baptist Church for allowing us the opportunity to minister here this morning. And we have great godly leadership at First Baptist Church, and we have a great church here, and we serve a great God. And it's a joy to be with you here this morning. One of the ways that God accomplishes his work is through prayer. What is prayer? Prayer is three things, at least three things. One, prayer is calling upon the name of the Lord. When we pray, we're calling upon the name of God the Father, through God the Son, by God the Spirit, and we're asking him or responding to him to fulfill his covenant promises in our lives. And if you look at the grand narrative of Scripture from Genesis to Revelation, the Word of God brings forth the creation, the fall, and the new creation. And beginning in Genesis 3:15, we see the beginning of what's referred to as the proto-evangelion, or the first gospel. And God begins to do a new work in redeeming mankind and the creative order. And he begins to establish a series of covenants. He begins by establishing a covenant with Noah. And he says in Genesis chapter 8 that God never again will curse the earth or mankind because of man. God is actually reversing the curse of sin and death through Jesus Christ. And in Genesis 3:15, we learn about the first gospel, that there would be a male who would come through the seed of a woman who would crush the head of Satan and whose heel would be nipped. So, secondly, after the Noahic covenant, then we see the Abrahamic covenant. God enters into a covenant with Abraham to bring forth at least three things. There are actually 14 promises in the Abrahamic covenant, but basically they're tied into three promises: the land, a seed, and the blessing. And the land is tied into the land of Israel, the first fruit of the land, and the whole creative order. The seed is the ultimately the Messiah. The physical seed is the Jewish people. The spiritual seed of Abraham is the church, Jewish and Gentile people who have given their lives to the Lord Jesus Christ, who are born again, filled with the Spirit, engrafted into Jesus Christ, the true vine, and a recipient of all of these covenant blessings, of which we're going to just briefly talk about as our introduction. So we have the Noahic covenant, and then the blessing, the land, the seed, and the blessing. The blessing is salvation. The blessing is salvation. Then we have the Mosaic covenant, where God enters into a covenant with Moses and giving us the law, the tabernacle, the priesthood, the blood sacrifice, all of which is meant to lead us to the holiness of God, our sinfulness, and our inability to save ourselves, and our need for a Savior. And all of the law of Moses, Paul tells us in Galatians chapter 3, are pointing to the Messiah, that the law is a tutor or a schoolmaster to lead us to faith in Christ. So we have the Noahic covenant, we have the Abrahamic covenant, we have the Mosaic covenant. We next have the Davidic covenant in 2 Samuel 7 and 1 Chronicles 17. The Davidic covenant promises us two things. One, an eternal king, and two, an eternal kingdom. In order to have a king and a kingdom, what do you need? You need kingdom citizens, and that's us who have given our lives to the Lord Jesus Christ through confession of our sin, repentance of our sin, and belief by faith in our risen Lord. So we have the Noahic covenant, the Abrahamic covenant, the Mosaic covenant, the Davidic covenant, and then finally we have the new covenant. Last but not least is the new covenant given to us in Deuteronomy 30, Ezekiel 36, and Jeremiah 31. And the new covenant is that that God has made with the nation of Israel, who we all participate in through faith, whether we're Jewish or Gentile, promises the forgiveness of sin, a born-again experience, the indwelling Holy Spirit, and eternal life. Amen. So through these series of covenants, God is restoring the blessing that was lost in Eden. Once sin came into the world in Genesis chapter 3, sin and death entered the world, and that's why we see all the problems that we have today, is because sin and death has entered the world. But through Jesus Christ, God is reversing that curse of sin and death through these series of covenants, all of which are fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And again, whether you're Jewish or Gentile, from whatever nation, tribe, tongue, or nationality, if you will confess your sins, repent of your sins, and believe by faith in our risen Lord, then you will be forgiven of your sin, cleansed of all unrighteousness, and born again as a new creation, and engrafted into Jesus Christ, the true vine, and a recipient of all of these covenant blessings, which are yes, in Christ our Lord. So when we are praying, we are calling upon the name of the Lord to fulfill his promises in our life. We're actually calling upon God through the Son, by the Spirit, to do exactly what he wants to do. We're yielding to him and asking him, dear Lord, fulfill your promises in my life, in my family, in the lives of others, in your church, and in the world. This is calling upon the name of the Lord. But secondly, when we pray, we're entering into God's work. And this is very important. Not only are we calling upon the name of the Lord, but we're also entering into God's work. And this is very important. We see that we're entering into the work of God's plan to redeem the world and a people for his own possession, but we're also entering into the work of God the Son and God the Spirit. In Romans chapter 8, verse 34, we read, God the Son, Jesus Christ, is he who died for our sins, who was raised from the dead, and who is seated right now at the right hand of the Father, and who also intercedes for us. So Jesus right now in his resurrected, risen form is seated at the right hand of the Father, Psalm 110. He is seated at the right hand of the Father and he is interceding for us. That's an incredible thing, and we are entering into that work of intercession. So not only are we calling upon the name of the Lord, but we're entering into the Lord's work, but it gets even better because God the Holy Spirit is also interceding for us. In Romans chapter 8, verses 26 and 27, Paul writes, God the Holy Spirit intercedes for the saints. Now listen to this phrase. He intercedes, the Holy Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. That's an incredible thing. So we're praying for the will of God in our lives, that God would fulfill his purposes. Jesus, the Son, is seated at the right hand of the Father, interceding according to the will of God. And God, the Holy Spirit, is interceding for us according to the will of God. So we're joining into his work when we pray, and it's a powerful, supernatural work that God has given us. As a matter of fact, it's a spiritual discipline. Prayer is a spiritual discipline. Well, you may ask, David, what is a spiritual discipline? A spiritual discipline is a biblical activity that when applied properly will put us in a position to receive the grace of God in our lives. And then be able to share that with others. Very important. There's a big difference here between Roman Catholicism and Protestantism. In Roman Catholicism and some of the mainline denominations, the disciplines actually infuse God's grace. Now, in Protestant theology, in biblical theology, the disciplines put us in a position to receive the grace of God. They don't actually infuse. It's the Holy Spirit that actually transforms us, and the Word of God, the living, breathing, active Word of God, is what transforms us by faith. But these spiritual disciplines put us in a position to receive this grace from God and then to share it with others. We have been blessed to bless others. We have been blessed to be a blessing to others. And when we understand that, then we begin to experience abundant life. So we see that what we have happening here is we have the plan of God, divine agency, and human responsibility. And this is the key to abundant life. God has this plan that he's fulfilling through his Son, by his Spirit. That's divine agency. And then we have human responsibility. We have our role. And this, we're calling upon the name of the Lord. We're entering into the Lord's work, and we're disciplining ourselves, putting us in a position to receive the grace of God, apply it in our lives by faith, and then in the lives of others. So our thesis this morning is very simply this. If you will, by faith, appropriate these three principles in your prayer life, there are many more, but this text talks about three specifically. If you will apply these three principles in your prayer life, you will experience the powerful transformation and covenant fulfillment that God desires in your life. Secondly, you will be able to help others experience the same transformation and covenant fulfillment. And then together, we will glorify God, enjoy abundant life, and fulfill the Great Commission together. So what we're going to look at today, we're going to see our three points this morning. If we will be consistent in our prayer life, if we will be personal in our prayer life, and if we will be confident in our prayer life, we will appropriate the power and transforming work of prayer in our life. So if you would please look with me at Philippians chapter 1, beginning in verse 3. I'm reading from the New American Standard Bible, the Word of God. I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, always offering prayer with joy in my every prayer for you all, in view of your participation in the gospel from the very first day until now. For I am confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus. Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. We come to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, by his shed blood and the power of your Holy Spirit, asking that through your Holy Spirit and through your living word that you would speak to us, speak to our heart, to our mind, and to our spirit, that we might be able to go to a deeper level in our prayer life, that we would be consistent, that we would be personal, and that we would be confident, Father, in our prayers that we lift up to you in Jesus' name. Amen. The first point that we're going to look at is that we must be consistent in our prayer. If we're going to appropriate the transforming power of God in our life, we must be consistent in our prayer. Now, in verses 3 through 6, there are four levels of consistency that Paul gives us in these verses. Four levels of consistency. First, there is repetition. Look with me in the first couple of verses of this. In four times in the first two verses, Paul says that he's praying for the saints in Philippi. In verse 3a, I thank my God. In verse 3b, in all my remembrance of you. Verse 4a, always offering prayer. And in verse 4b, in my every prayer for you all. In these two verses, four times, Paul says that he's praying for the saints in Philippi. I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, always offering prayer in my every prayer for you all. So there's repetition in Paul's prayer life. Secondly, we see the degree now of Paul's prayer. Not only is he repetitively repeating, but we also look at the degree, and we have one adverb and three adjectives that describe the degree of Paul's prayer. He says, in all my remembrance of you, always offering prayer, in my every prayer for you all. Now, Paul may have been a Southerner. He says, I'm praying for you all. So he may have been from the south of Israel. But south of Cilicia, actually. He was from Cilicia. But so not only four times does he say, I'm praying, but he says, I'm always in every prayer, all the time, always praying for you. So repetition and then the degree. But now look at the time. Look at the time element that we have here. In verse 5, he says, from the very first day. And if you go back to Acts chapter 16, you see the birth of the Philippian church with Lydia and a group of women praying by the river. So from the very first day he began, then he says, until now, the time of his letter, and then in verse 6 at the end, until the day of Christ Jesus. So look at the scope, the time frame of his prayer. He began praying for them initially, then he is continuing to pray, and he's going to continue to pray for them until the day of Christ Jesus. So we have the repetition, we have the degree, and we also have the time. But then fourthly, we see the verb tense of Paul's thanksgiving. And if you look at that word, I thank my God, that word thank is a, I won't go into all the verb tenses, but it demonstrates continuous action. In other words, he is continually, always, at all times, offering up every kind of prayer, and he's doing it continuously from the very first day until now, until the day of Christ Jesus. And I must confess to you, I don't have a prayer life like this. I don't have a prayer life like the Apostle Paul. I would like to have one like the Apostle Paul, and I think all of us are moving in that direction or allowing God to move us in that direction, but this is just incredible. Again, on four levels, repetition, degree, time, and verb tense, Paul is consistently praying. But what is the content of Paul's prayer? He says, I'm always giving thanks. Now, thankfulness is a foundational element in the Christian life. We're responding to the work of God in our lives when we give thanks. We have received his grace. We have received his mercy. We have received his provision. We have received his salvation. We have received abundant life. Therefore, one of the key elements of the Christian life is to be thankful. We're thankful, we're responding to God. In this case, Paul is responding to God in prayer for the saints at Philippi. But also, it's with joy. It is with joy. Now, if you ever get an email or a card from Jennifer Sims, you know that she always signs that with joy. And I know that all of us have some kind of a little signature that we like to sign at the end. You know, I like to sign, "Together in Christ for the Gospel." But if you get a note or an email from Jennifer Sims, it'll be "With Joy," because she understands that joy is a spiritual gift that's not circumstantial. Joy is not circumstantial. It's a spiritual gift that no matter what is happening, we have this inner joy welling up in our hearts. Now, our face may not always show it. You know, our attitude may not always show it. Some of the things we do may not always show it, but there should be in all of our lives, if we're a born-again, spirit-filled, spirit-led Christian, there should be this underlying fruit of joy manifested in our life. And it really comes from a crucified flesh and being rightly related to God and to others in our life. And we're walking in the Spirit. We're being led by the Spirit. We're filled with the Spirit. We're being led by the Holy Spirit. We're in the very center of God's will in our relationship with Him and with others. And this produces abundant joy. And this is exactly what's happening, again, in the life of our Lord Jesus Christ. In Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25, the writer says, "God the Son, Jesus Christ, is able to save forever those who draw near to God through Him, since He always lives to make intercession for us." Again, Paul is modeling his prayer. All truth comes from God. We model God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. In Jesus' prayer life, He always lives to make intercession for us. Paul is always praying for the saints in Philippi. Therefore, we should always be praying for one another. And then in 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 and 18, Paul says, and I love this verse, and many, I know many of you do too. Paul says, "Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and in everything give thanks, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus." So what Paul is saying is, this isn't only my prayer life. This is what I desire in your life. And this is what we should be desiring as born-again, spirit-filled, spirit-led Christians, that we would be rejoicing always, praying without ceasing, and in everything give thanks. So the first characteristic of powerful transforming prayer is that it is consistent. Now, all of us should have planned times of prayer. Maxie and I begin our morning, as many of you do, in the Word of God and in prayer, individually and together. So we have these planned times of prayer in the morning, in the afternoon, in the evening. But then there are those spontaneous times of prayer where you come upon someone and there's something happening in their lives that needs the Lord's specific attention, and you pray. You just pray. And I would encourage you, don't wait until you get home to pray. Why not pray with them right there? Pray with them right there. So we have these planned times of prayer throughout the day, and then we have those spontaneous opportunities that are led by the Spirit. All prayer is led by God. Pray in the Spirit. And the idea is that we're in such close communion, intimate fellowship with God, that His desires are our desires. And that when He speaks, we respond, and we're in unison. This is actually what communion is. You're in unity, calm unity with God and with each other. So, secondly, now we're going to see that prayer is personal. Now, personal has an individual element and a corporate element. Just because something is personal doesn't mean it only involves me. This is a very important principle. Personal can have an individual element and a corporate element, and that's what we see in this verse. Paul says in verse 3, he says, "I thank my God." Paul has a personal relationship with God the Father through God the Son by God the Holy Spirit. There was a point in Paul's life in Acts chapter 9 when he was on the road to Damascus and he had decrees from the Sanhedrin in Jerusalem to go to Damascus and to bring all of the Jewish believers back to Jerusalem to be tried and killed. And on his way to Damascus, he has this encounter with the risen Lord. And at that time, he confessed his sin, he repented of his sin, and he believed by faith in the risen Lord. He was in the home of Ananias, another Jewish believer, who was, quite frankly, scared to death of Paul because he had a reputation. He was a killer. So Paul knows God the Father through God the Son by God the Spirit in a personal way. Now, if you look at the nature of God, God is in a personal relationship with himself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. God is one. The word that's used in the Bible is echad. It means a unity of one, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So God is in a personal relationship with himself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we being created in the image of God, male and female, have that same type of relationship. We're to live in relationship. So Paul begins by saying, I thank my God. He knows God in a personal way, a redemptive way, through God the Son, by God the Spirit. But then he says in verse 5, in view of your participation. So here's the corporate element of this personal nature of prayer. That your participation, he's speaking about the entire church at Philippi, their participation in the gospel. Now, what's very important about this is that Paul uses a very special word. That word participation is the Greek word koinonia. And many of you have heard that word. Many of you know what that word means, but it means a sharing together. It means fellowship. It means communion on its deepest level. Koinonia is fellowship and sharing and communion on its deepest level. So Paul says, my prayer is giving thanks to my God for you, for your koinonia or communion or participation or your sharing in the gospel. Very important. So there's an individual and a corporate element to Paul's thanksgiving. And I would like to go through just exactly this type of koinonia because it's powerful. And we experience that here. And at the end of this, at the application for our message, we're going to look at our disciples' pathway to growing in Christ. This is our process for fulfilling exactly what Paul is going to share with us here. So what is this koinonia? What is this fellowship, this sharing that he's talking about? Well, the first one is the fellowship of ministry. And look with me in verse 7 and 8. Paul says, it is only right for me to feel this way. He says, it's only right for me to feel this way, thankfulness and praying for you, because I have you in my heart. Since both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, you are partakers of grace with me. For God is my witness how I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. That is koinonia. Where is Paul? Paul's in prison in Rome. He is writing to the saints in Philippi, and he says to them, it's only right to me for me to be constantly giving thanks with joy to you for your participation in the gospel because I have you in my heart. There was a heart connection. Again, individual and corporate relationship. since both in my imprisonment and in the defense of the gospel, you are all partakers with me. And we share in the grace of God. We're united with God the Father through God the Son, by God the Spirit. God the Holy Spirit indwells us, and he unites us together as brothers and sisters in Christ. This is what Paul is saying. And then he says, "For God is my witness how I long for you with the affection of Christ Jesus." In other words, the love that God has poured into Paul's heart is now being poured out into the lives of others. Paul would write later in another book, it's the love of God that compels us to love God and to love one another. And this is koinonia. So it's the fellowship of ministry, but it's also the fellowship of proclamation. Look with me in chapter 1, verse 15. "Some, to be sure, are preaching Christ even from envy and strife, but some also from goodwill. The latter do it out of love, knowing that I am appointed for the defense of the gospel. The former proclaim Christ out of selfish ambition rather than from pure motives, thinking to cause me distress in my imprisonment." In other words, you know the story of Paul. He would go into an area, share the gospel, lead people to faith in Christ, plant churches, disciple leaders, and move on. And in many cases, he would visit them again, or he would write letters back to them. But what always happened? There would always be false teachers coming in behind him and challenging his apostleship and his teaching. And he says, some are preaching the gospel out of impure motives, and some are preaching out of pure motives. But look what he says in verse 18. "What then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed, and in this I rejoice." So he said, hey, whatever the pretense, if it's evil or good, what's important is that Christ is proclaimed. And he rejoices in that, and that's that koinonia. From this pulpit, from the choir and orchestra, from the Bible study and discipleship classes, to every home that's represented here and in our membership, in offices, in schools, all over Bay County, we can rejoice together because the word of God is going forth from the saints at First Baptist Church. It's always going forth. The word of God roars from Zion, and it roars from every place where a Christian is from this congregation. And through that, Paul rejoices. He says there's koinonia, there's fellowship in that. But then there is the koinonia of suffering in chapter 1, 29 and 30. Paul writes, "For you it has been granted for Christ's sake not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for his sake, experiencing the same conflict which you saw in me and now hear to me." So Paul is saying in the big narrative, Christ suffered. He looked beyond the suffering of the cross to the joy that lie ahead. I, Paul, am suffering. You too, it has been granted to suffer. And this word granted is a very special word. It has some linkage to grace. It has the first three letters of the word for grace, charis. So it's an element of God's grace. We tend to think of grace in only a good thing, but when we view suffering, if we have a biblical theology of suffering, suffering is for our good. If it's for the right reason, you know, we suffer for a few things. One, we suffer because we're a fallen creation living in a fallen world among fallen people. So there's just, you know, there's death and suffering and disease. We just can't help it. Then we also suffer because of our own sin and our own unwise decisions. But then thirdly, we suffer for righteousness' sake. We're pursuing the Lord, we're following hard after God, and that creates a tension with the world and spiritual warfare. And God, even in our suffering, wants to purify our faith. If we will respond properly to suffering and understand a biblical theology of suffering, our faith will be purified, it will be strengthened, we will grow stronger, and then we'll be able to help others. Again, we're blessed that we might bless others. So if we respond properly to this suffering, we're going to be able to be strengthened, purified in our faith, and then help others. But then next, there's the fellowship of the Spirit. We've looked at the fellowship of ministry, the koinonia of proclamation, the koinonia of suffering. There's also the fellowship of the Spirit, and this is beautiful. Look with me in chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, where Paul writes, "Therefore, if there is any encouragement in Christ, if there is any consolation of love, if there is any fellowship," there's that word koinonia, "if there is any fellowship in the Spirit, if any affection and compassion," and we would say amen, 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 and amen. We're experiencing all of that right there. He says, if there is, it's a hypothetical rhetorical question. Then he says in verse 2, "Make my joy complete by being of the same mind, maintaining the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose." That's koinonia. You know, we're Jewish and Gentile believers from all tribes and tongues and nations and nationalities. We're all different, but we're united in our humanness, in our salvation, in the body of Christ, in the Spirit, with one purpose. And we want to be united in that because that's where the power is. When we're united with God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we're united with other, we're going to receive a return to the first century church. We will see the salvation, the healings, the reconciliation. We'll see the church planting. We'll see a fulfillment of the Great Commission in our generation when we experience the kind of koinonia that Paul is talking about here. But then there's the koinonia of worship. Look with me in chapter 3, verses 1 and 3. Paul says, "Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord." He uses rejoice and joy 13 times in this letter. One of the primary themes of Philippians is joy and rejoicing. So he says, "Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. To write these things again is no trouble to me, and it's a safeguard to you. Beware of the dogs, beware of the evil workers, beware of the false circumcision." He's mentioning Gentile and Jewish evil workers that are trying to undermine the ministry, undermine the church, and undermine his apostleship. For he says, very important verse, "For we, Jewish and Gentile believers, are the circumcision who worship in the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and who put no confidence in the flesh." Our ministry, our life is not a fleshly endeavor. It doesn't matter how smart you are, what you look like, how much education you have, where you come from, what your parents were. None of that matters. What matters is that we're a new creation indwelt by the Holy Spirit, and we're united in the Lord, fulfilling his purposes. Jesus made it very clear in the Sermon on the Mount early on in his ministry in Matthew 6:13. He said, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be added to you." And this is the idea that Paul is getting across here. So we have the communion of the ministry and proclamation and suffering, spirit and worship, but then there's also giving and receiving. Look with me in chapter 4, verse 15. The ministry of giving and receiving. There's koinonia in that. Chapter 4, verse 15. You yourselves also know, Philippians, that at the first preaching of the gospel, after I left Macedonia, Philippi is in Macedonia, no church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving, but you alone. Now, let's think about what Paul is saying here. Paul planted the Philippian church on his second missionary journey. He said, of all the churches that I've planted and raised up leaders and discipled and continued to write back about encouraging them in the faith, he's in prison now. And after he left Macedonia, there was only one church that continued to support him in his ministry, and that was the church at Philippi. Then he said in verse 16, for even in Thessalonica, you sent a gift more than once for our needs. Now, again, this is first century. They didn't have electronic monetary transfer or, you know, I mean, I even shudder to think what the mail system was like back in those days. But, you know, they sent more than one gift to him. Not that I seek the gift itself, but I seek the profit which increases to your account. Paul said, my joy in thanksgiving is not because of my needs are being met. My joy in thanksgiving is because of what God is doing in your life because of your faithfulness in the Lord. That's koinonia, when we can enjoy one another's giving and receiving and benefit from that. And then the last one is the koinonia of the resurrection. We have that to look forward to. Look with me in chapter 3, verse 10. Paul says, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being conformed to his death, in order that I may attain to the resurrection of the dead. Amen. Paul says, he just comes off this, he says, you know, we are the true circumcision, Jewish and Gentile believers in Christ, one in the Lord. We're the true circumcision. Then he says, if people do have an opportunity to boast in the flesh, I more so, and he goes through his pedigree. But then he says, but all of that is rubbish. All of that is rubbish. He says, what I want to know is Jesus. He says, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, that power that lies within us that raised Jesus from the dead, and the koinonia of his suffering, being conformed to his death, in order that I may attain the resurrection of the dead. So again, everything that Jesus was, is, and is to come, this is the, we are created in the image of God. Jesus is the image of the invisible God. Jesus in his humanity is everything that God desires us for and we have that lies in store for us in the eschaton. And so he says, that I may know him. And this is a, there are three words in the New Testament for knowledge. One is oida, it's factual knowledge, just pure fact. Number two is gnosko, which is experiential personal knowledge. And that's what Paul is talking about here. Then there's the word epigenosko, which is true or complete knowledge. But he's using the word gnosko here, that intimate experiential knowledge. That's all Paul wants. He said, forget about all of that pedigree. He said, all I want to do is know Christ intimately, personally, and live in communion with him. And the power of his resurrection, to experience that resurrection power in our lives. And it comes through prayer. And the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, in order that I may attain to the resurrection of the dead. Amen. But you may say, well, David, he's only talking about himself, but look where he goes from here. Look in verse 20. Now he includes the corporate nature of this. He says, for our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the posture of our life, this side of the return of Christ. We're eagerly waiting and anticipating, faithfully serving the Lord until he comes. This is an incredible posture, for our citizenship is in heaven, for which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now look what happens when he comes. Verse 21, who will transform the body of our humble state, this humble, fleshly, temporal state. He will transform the body of our humble state into conformity with the body of his glory. Can you imagine that? His glory, our bodies are going to be transformed into his glorious resurrection body. That's a hallelujah chorus right there. In class at the Baptist College of Florida, whenever we come across things and the Spirit leads it, I've got a button on the computer. It's the hallelujah chorus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. And everybody breaks out, you know, because man, this is joy. This is communion. So he says, who will transform the body of our humble state in conformity with the body of his glory by the exercising of the power that he has even to subject all things to himself. God the Father has subjected all things to Jesus, his son, right now. And we have access to that power through prayer, through the spiritual discipline of prayer, through calling upon the name of the Lord. Amen. Now, this koinonia is typified or given to us to experience in the Spirit, and it's represented in communion. When we take communion, it's a picture of koinonia, and it's the very same verse, the very same word, rather, that Paul uses here. In 1 Corinthians 10, verses 16 and 17, and don't turn there, just listen to this. Paul is talking about the Lord's Supper and sharing in the body and blood of Christ. He says, is not the cup of blessing which we bless a sharing of the blood of Christ? Is not the bread which we break a sharing or koinonia of the body of Christ? Since there is one bread, we who are one body, for we all partake, that it's a derivative of koinonia, we all partake of one bread. So when we sit down to the Lord's table and take of the bread and the cup, this is a physical picture of a spiritual reality that we have as brothers and sisters in Christ in koinonia. This is what an ordinance is. When Pastor Clyde Ellison baptized these two young ladies today, that baptism is a physical picture of a spiritual reality, entering into Christ in his death, burial, and resurrection to walk in newness of life, a cleansing of sin, a cleansing of the old self, raised to walk as a new creation in newness of life. The Lord's Supper, we're sitting down and we're symbolically, and I want to this is important. It's a symbol. The bread and the cup are symbols of the body and blood of Christ. And we are partaking that as a symbol of our koinonia with Christ in his death, our need for salvation, and the unity that we share in all of that. Very important. So Paul talks about the koinonia, their participation in the gospel. But then lastly, confidence, the confidence that we have that God is going to fulfill his work. And this is faith. A biblical definition of faith is in Hebrews 11, verse 1, where the writer of Hebrews says, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen. And if you do a study of that verse, faith is the assurance of things hoped for. That word assurance means essence or reality, the person and work of God. And that word hoped for is expected. So faith is the essence, the reality of that which is expected. What do we expect? We expect the covenant blessings of God. A covenant is a legal agreement that God has made with mankind, given to us in Scripture, appropriated in our lives by faith. So faith is the reality of things expected because of covenant applied by faith, and the conviction of things unseen. Three levels of conviction. The Holy Spirit convicts me that it's true. The Word of God convicts me that it's true. And my conscience convicts me that this is true. There are three levels of conviction. I'm persuaded that God is fulfilling his covenant blessings right here in this church. The godly leadership that we have, the proclamation of the word, the evangelistic outreach that's going on all over the place and around the world through the cooperative program. So this is why Paul can say in verse 6, I am confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus. He is confident that God is going to fulfill his work. God is at work in the Philippians. God is at work in us. And then he says in Philippians 2, verse 12, that we're to work out our salvation. God has worked it in. He's working in us, and we're to work it out. It's not a works-based salvation, but we respond in faith. Work is a demonstration of our faith. We don't work for our salvation. It's a demonstration of the authenticity of our faith, that we're about the Lord's business. And in the book of James, some didn't even want to include the book of James in the New Testament canon because of a biblical understanding of faith and works. James says, Jacob actually said, you show me a man's works and I'll show you his faith, because he's working out, or she is working out, their salvation in spirit and truth. And this is what prayer does. Consistent, personal, and confident prayer that God is doing his work in us if we will respond in faith and obedience. Now, just quickly as we end, I'd like to look at our disciple pathway. This is how we fulfill these verses here at First Baptist Church. This is Pastor Bill Sears, one of his life ministries. And he and Pastor Bill Sears and Jennifer Sims, all of our pastors, if you have been to any of our leadership meetings, you've seen this discipleship path. This is our process here at First Baptist Church for fulfilling exactly what Paul is talking about here in the lives of the Philippians. It all begins with evangelism. And in the fall, Pastor Rick McClung is going to be starting up the new semester of Share Outreach. And I would encourage you to be there. Be there on Monday nights starting in the fall under Pastor McClung's leadership to learn how to share your faith. Everybody should know how to share their faith through a personal testimony, short and long version, a recovery testimony, a marked New Testament, a gospel track, one of the devices. Everybody should know how to share their faith in any type of situation. And I can guarantee if you will come on Monday night starting in the fall, you will learn how to do it. You'll learn how to do it relationally. And then we'll go out and have an opportunity to do it. Whenever you teach someone to do something, you want to give them opportunity to minister. And that's exactly what we do here under Pastor McClung's leadership. So evangelism, then worship, individual, small group, and corporate worship. It's a lifestyle. When we come in here under Pastor Ken, we have corporate worship. We're worshiping corporately in song and fellowship and the word and prayer. Then our connection groups. Our connection groups are our small group ministries, our Sunday school, all of the small group ministries that meet all throughout the week in the morning, afternoon, and evening, constantly going on. There is a discipleship class for you, whether you're a child, if you're a teenager, if you're a single, if you're a young married couple, if you're a young family, if you're middle age, if you're an empty nester, if you're a senior adult, senior saint, whatever your role in life is right now. There is a discipleship ministry, and you'll be getting a booklet for that coming up in the fall. Then discipleship opportunities, we mentioned that, and then the opportunity to serve. 2 weeks ago, we had almost 200 teenagers here from all over the Southeast, and we were ministering alongside World Changers, ministering and serving our community. We serve Cedar Grove Elementary School. All of you are serving in areas of in your neighborhood, at work, at school. There are opportunities, and this is our process. This is a disciple's path to growing in Christ, and it's what we use here, a biblical process for fulfilling exactly what Paul is talking about here. And God is doing it. This is a great church, and it has great leadership, and it has great membership. And we live in the most exciting generation ever in the history of mankind. This year, we're celebrating the 500th anniversary of the Reformation. This year is the 50th anniversary of the reunification of the city of Jerusalem. Next year is the 70th anniversary of the rebirth of the modern nation of Israel. This year is the 70th anniversary of the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls. All of these are signs that God's word is being fulfilled, that the Lord Jesus Christ is coming back for his saints, and we're to be about his work. And this is how it's done here at First Baptist Church. Father in heaven, we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we have no words, Father, to express our love and appreciation for who you are and what you have done for us in your Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, as we enter this time of invitation, dear God, we ask in Jesus' name that your Holy Spirit would sweep across this sanctuary, that you would have your way with us. If there be anybody here that is not genuinely born again, filled with your Holy Spirit, forgiven of their sin, and born again as a new creation, Lord, your Holy Spirit is calling them. The Holy Spirit is calling you, if you are not a believer in Jesus Christ, that you would respond, that you would get up out of your seat, enter the aisle, come downstairs, come forward to meet one of our pastors that are right here in front of us. The Holy Spirit is calling you. Maybe you're here and you have given your life to the Lord. You are born again, but you've wandered away from the faith. You've wandered away from the Lord. You've wandered away from his church. The Holy Spirit is calling you to come back to fellowship, to confess your sins, repent of your sins, and be restored to that koinonia that Paul is talking about in Philippians. Maybe you're here today and you do not have a church home, and whether you're here for the first time today or you've been attending, Lord, the Lord is calling you to join this church. This is a great church. So we're asking you in Jesus' name, if the Holy Spirit is moving you, to come forward to join First Baptist Church. Perhaps you're praying about a particular ministry here. You feel the Holy Spirit moving you in a particular direction to serve, use your gifts and calling and talents in service. Come to the altar and pray with one of our pastors, or come here to the altar and pray and ask God to reveal the ministry that he would have you to be involved in. Father, have your way with us. Maybe you're just here and you're rejoicing over the blessings of God and you want to give him thanks. Come forward and express your joy. Father, we love you. We thank you. We pray now during this invitation that you would have your way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'm so glad that you've chosen to tune in to our broadcast. And it's the prayer of my heart, as you have walked into our worship center by way of television, that you have been encouraged as you have listened to the great music that's been provided by our sanctuary choir and orchestra, and as you have listened to the instruction that has come from God's Word, that you really have been strengthened with something that will help you in your walk with God. And if you have yet to discover the wonderful gift of salvation that is provided to us through Jesus Christ our Lord, I pray that you might call upon His name.